In this topic, we're going to talk about securing web API with Azure Active Directory. We have some other modules on specifically on Azure Active Directory, but we're going to apply it to a scenario here and talk about how security applies to web API and some of the complexities that are involved with that. It's not quite as straightforward as clicking a checkbox or turning something on in the platform. And so I'm going to walk through a scenario here of a typical application that we run into and how we are able to leverage Azure Active Directory to provide authentication services for the app, but then also allow the web API tier to be split. So when we're talking about scalable applications and being able to keep our different layers of the application separate, that brings in some complexity, especially with authentication. If we don't have domain join membership, which we typically don't in PaaS type systems, then we need to have some other mechanism to synchronize our identities and make sure that everything can authenticate and we can have trusted clients that we're talking to. So in this scenario, we're going to talk about a web app. So in this case, we'll have a front end here, and I'll just put FE here, and this will be a web app. We could actually say this is a SPA type application or a heavy JavaScript type application. And then in the back end, we actually, and we'll call this BE, this is our back end, and this will be web API. Now both of these are ASP.NET applications. This one's heavy, the front end's heavily JavaScript, and the back end is heavily MVC or web API in this case that we're talking about. And then obviously we would have a data store over here, we'll just call it SQL for the argument's sake, that the web API would communicate with. Now, our users are coming into a front-end application over here. And these users need to access this app, and maybe this app is locked down, so we don't want just everybody in the world to hit this, but remember, these are public endpoints that are exposed here. So this thing's exposed to the public internet. Unless we have ACLs in place, anybody can access it. But if we were able to leverage something like OWIN, so we have an OWIN framework that helps us abstract away some of the intricacies of the identity system. And what this allows us to do is basically define a relationship between our Azure AD down here and our application. So we define our application down here, and this is basically metadata about this guy. And so when we define that metadata down here in the Azure AD, there's a key that's involved. Again, this is on server side. And then we have a key involved in our application, again, on the server side. And that key will allow these two to communicate, basically, OWIN working through that. So when the application fires up, it will use OWIN to initiate and initialize all this glue that kind of glues our Active Directory to there. And then it becomes easy in our application to say whether this person is authorized. There's literally a property inside of our application that says whether this request is authorized. If it's not, we'll have to go get a token. And when we go get a token, that's defined through our OWIN configuration here. So in our OWIN configuration, this will essentially redirect this application to a default screen that basically asks them for their username and their password. And this resides in Azure. So this is the Azure AD login. If anybody's used Office 365, this is the same login screen that you're going to see there. Now, we can customize it for our apps and put the app name and that kind of stuff in there. But we're going to ask them for what is your username, which typically is their UPN or their email. And what happens is, once we have that, we can ask Azure Active Directory behind the scenes, hey, is this a federated user or a cloud user? And when I say cloud user, I mean someone who doesn't have an on-premises connectivity to Azure, which basically would be like if we had Azure or Active Directory over here, and we had a synchronization running there with our DIR sync or our Azure Active Directory sync. If we don't have that, he's going to say that's a cloud user, and we're going to prompt them for their password here. So they would enter their password. Whether it was the right password or not, then they get into the application. If they were a federated user, so let's say we had this synchronization running here, when they type in that UPN, it's going to say, oh, they're a federated user, and it's going to redirect them back over here to on-premises. They'll get a authentication request. They'll make sure that they can authenticate. It'll come back to Azure Active Directory with either a yes or no. And at that point, a token will be generated or not for the web app. Now, this works all fine, and everything is pretty easy to configure here. Very small amount of code that has to be added for OWIN. We do some configuration. I mentioned over here on this side in Azure, this is all Azure configuration. But then we start sprinkling in the web API. Now, the web API is a way for us to get data. So we logged into the app over here, but then this guy is going to make REST calls over to this web API layer. Now, that web API has methods there, and we can decorate those with the authorize attribute, which also integrates with OWIN. So this web API has a configuration with OWIN as well. So in this model, what can happen is once we get the authentication token over here from our initial login, we can actually pass that every time that we come over here to Web API and say, here's my token. This guarantees I'm allowed to access that data. Now, because he has this relationship defined here, he can actually check on that request and say, hang on a second, let me check that out and make sure that's clear. So he'll check and make sure that that token is actually valid. And if it is valid, he'll let them have access to that data. So in this model, we can have a two-tier application because we have our UI here and we have our service layer here. And in this model, we can actually have the token actually being passed between those different layers. So kind of a hard thing to do when we didn't have some of these nice features like Azure Active Directory and OWIN.
So I imagine that I could also tie in with something like a two-form factor like Azure MFA?
Sure, yeah, and it also supports third-party. So we don't have to necessarily use ADFS. If they want to use something like a third-party IDP, we can actually plug that into the system too. So,
in fact, I can show you what that kind of looks like here. So on my screen, I have fired up in my Azure subscription, I had created an ACS namespace. So one thing you need to be aware of, this is kind of the current state. It still exists. It eventually is going to evolve into something else. We don't know exactly yet. But as you see right here on the screen, we can actually add in a Facebook application, Windows Live ID, Google, or Yahoo. And this is another way we can put in one of those public providers in there to authenticate against that.
Yeah, it's a great point, Mark, and that's the way we can integrate even more authentication systems. So when you see those things on the internet that's leveraging your Facebook credentials to log on to a certain website, this is actually what's happening behind the scenes, and we can leverage the same thing in our apps.
Exactly.
So that kind of wraps the topic on identity integration, especially with web API in our Azure applications.